Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to Jubilant Pharmova Limited earnings conference call for the quarter and half year ended September 30th, 2021. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the opening remarks. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Vineet Mayer, Head of Investor Relations at Jubilant Pharmova Limited. Thank you, and over to you.
Thank you, Stanford. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for being with us on our Q2 FY 2022 earnings conference call. I would like to remind you that some of the statements made on the call today could be forward-looking in nature. Detailed disclaimer in this regard has been included in the press release that has been shared on our website. On the call today, we have Mr. Shyam Bhartia, Chairman, Mr. Hari Bhartia, Co-Chairman and Managing Director, Mr. Arvind Chokhany, Group CFO, Mr. Pramod Yadav, CEO, Jubilant Pharma, Mr. Giuliano Perfetti, CEO, Jubilant Biosys, Mr. Syed Kazmi, CEO, Jubilant Therapeutics, and Mr. Arun Sharma, CFO, Jubilant Pharmova. I now invite Mr. Shyam Bhartia to share his comments.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. I hope you and your family are safe and healthy. The company reported 4% top-line growth during the quarter, driven by steady revenues in the pharmaceutical segment and robust growth in the contract research and development services segment. In the pharmaceutical segment, while radiopharma, allergy, and CMO businesses reported growth on year-on-year basis, the API business performance was lower on a higher base last year, and generic business witnessed headwinds due to temporary pricing pressure in the U.S. market. Generic business was also affected during the quarter by import alert at Roorkee plant and by the impact of the industry-wide impurity issue in certain sartan products that led to the lower sales and some product withdrawals. In our contract research and development services business, we witnessed strong growth both year-on-year and sequentially, driven by continued strong demand from our customers for our drug discovery services. In proprietary novel drug business, our plans are on track to take one program to the clinic stage by the end of this financial year. Our strategic initiatives of API demerger is progressing well, and we have received consents from the bondholders and term loan holders and have filed the first motion in NCLT in September 2021. We expect to complete this reorganization by the end of this financial year. During H1 FY 2022, we grew our revenues by 20% year-on-year and improved our EBITDA margins by 2.44% versus H1 FY 2021 due to recovery of radiopharma business and strong performance in allergy immunotherapy, CMO, API, and contract research businesses. I would like to mention that over the medium term, we have very strong growth levers in all our businesses. To drive growth in these businesses, the company will continue to invest accordingly. I would like to welcome Giuliano Perfetti, who has joined as the CEO of Jubilant Biosys Limited and brings with him over two decades of experience across businesses and global markets. I wish Giuliano all the best. I am confident that he would play a strong role in further strengthening and scaling up our contract research and development services business under Jubilant Biosys. With this, I hand over to Pramod to discuss the pharma business.
Thank you, Mr. Bhartiya. A very good evening to all of you. Pharmaceutical revenue was at ₹1,543 crore versus ₹1,516 crore in Q2 FY21. Our radio pharma business witnessed improvement in sales year on year. However, pace of recovery during the quarter was affected by increase in COVID-19 cases in the US. I would like to mention that we continue to maintain majority market share in key products in this business. The RubyFill installations during the quarter were affected by the higher COVID-19 cases in the US. We remain, however, bullish on RubyFill given its unique benefit to the patients and have completed the doubling of RubyFill manufacturing capacity, which will enable continued growth in this product over the near medium term. Our NDA I-131 MIBG clinical trials, both for phase 2 and phase 3, are progressing satisfactorily. Radiopharmacy business witnessed steady performance year on year. However, volumes were somewhat impacted during the quarter due to ebbs and flow of COVID-19. Our aggressive turnaround plan is on track to grow top line strongly with new customer links, expand network to service newer geographies, and enhance cost and procurement efficiencies. And we have witnessed positive outcome over the last two quarters. The allergy immunotherapy reported robust performance, both year on year and sequentially, with strong recovery from COVID-19, backed by healthy growth in revenue resulting from volumes higher than pre-COVID levels. In our CMO business, we witnessed year-on-year growth in revenue, driven by continued strong demand from customers, as well as due to COVID-related deals. In addition to ₹200 crore COVID-related revenue that we realized in Q1 FY22, we booked around ₹150 crore of COVID-related revenue in Q2 FY22. This is against ₹93 crore in Q2 FY21. With pandemic cases showing downward trend, the CMO performance is expected to return to normal levels in coming quarters. The capacity expansion project at Spokane is underway and is expected to complete by end of calendar year 24. Once completed, this will open further growth avenues for the CMO business. Performance of our API business was lower year on year due to higher base last year, but sequentially it witnessed a strong growth with stable margins. We expect this trend to continue, though of late, we are seeing price increase for some of key starting materials being imported from China, as well as increasing solvent and utility cost in India. We expect this cost to be passed through finished goods prices. We are also reducing our dependency on imports from China for KSMs by developing them indigenously. Our API business demerger, as mentioned by Chairman, is underway, and once completed, it will create a robust platform that provides end-to-end services. I am sorry, there was some echo in the background. That will provide end-to-end services from drug discovery services to the clinical research to contract manufacturing of innovative and the generic APIs and would unlock massive potential for growth over the medium term. Our generic business reported lower revenue and profit during the quarter due to several factors such as pricing pressure in the US market, lower volumes due to import alert at the Roorkee plant, and industry-wide import issue in sartans that led to voluntary withdrawals. This was partly mitigated by higher remdesivir sales. The EBITDA for quarter was at rupees 324 crore as compared to rupees 343 crore in Q2 FY21. In H1 FY22, pharmaceutical business revenue was up by 18% year-on-year, driven by recovery in radiopharma and strong growth in allergy immunotherapy, CMO, and API businesses. The generic business also grew by 8% year-on-year in H1 FY21. The EBITDA during H1 FY22 grew by 32% versus H1 FY21, with 2.28% improvement in margins to 22.2%. With regard to Roorkee import alert, our remediation activities are ongoing as per the plan, and we expect to complete the same early next calendar year. The Nanjangud OI status remains as it is. We have completed remediation activities and await US FDA inspection. With this, I hand over to Giuliano to provide insight into contract research and development services business.
Thank you, Pramod. I'm excited to become part of the Jubilant Barsa Group, and I'm glad to interact with you all through this earnings call for the first time. At Jubilant Biosys, we have a robust platform with all the levers to significantly scale up this business, both in terms of capabilities and capacities. In our contract research and development service business, under the Jubilant Biosys brand, we delivered another quarter of strong performance during Q2 FY22, driven by continued strong demand from biotech companies for our integrated discovery, as well as functional services such as chemistry, DMPK, and discovery biology. The business has a healthy pipeline of new contracts and customer acquisition for FY22. Q2 FY22 revenue grew 44% year-on-year, and EBITDA grew 73% year-on-year with a margin of 32.9% versus 27.4% in Q2 FY21. Our H1 FY22 revenue was up by 49% year-on-year, EBITDA by 81% year-on-year, and margin stood at 35.6%. I'm also glad to mention that our new state-of-the-art Chemistry Research Innovation Center at Noida is now fully operational. The new facility has been designed with highest global compliance standards to support both biotech and big pharma by delivering speed, quality, and innovation. In view of the strong demand from our customers, we have approved further expansion of the Greater Noida facility, which will deliver both chemistry and DMPK services. With this, I now hand over to Said to discuss the proprietary novel drugs pipeline.
Thanks, Giuliano. Good evening, everyone. In our proprietary novel drug business, we are developing a pipeline of first-in-class and best-in-class agents to deliver precision medicines focused on addressing unmet medical needs in the area of oncology and autoimmune disorders. We are also leveraging our industry-validated drug discovery platform to identify novel promising assets and move them from discovery to development on an accelerated timeline. Our first-in-class LSD1 HDAC6 dual inhibitor addresses multi-billion dollar market segments in both hematological malignancies and solid tumors, and has successfully completed pre-IND meeting with FDA with a goal to file the IND by end of calendar year 2021 and initiate first-in-human clinical studies in early 2022. Following this lead, a first-in-class PAD4 targeting autoimmune disorders such as rheumatoid arthritis, subsets, as well as metastatic cancer, a differentiated PRMT5 inhibitor with potential best-in-class profile, which uniquely shows both blood and brain exposure, and therefore can address brain tumors like GBM and brain metastasis, and finally an oral brain-penetrant PD-L1 inhibitor, first ever potential checkpoint therapy for brain tumors. We anticipate the submission of additional INDs by the end of 2022. In our proprietary novel drug business, we are developing very high potential assets that have attracted significant interest from institutional investors and strategic partners. The company is working towards creating shareholder value in this business through an external capital raise or potential partnering with major global pharmaceutical companies. With this, I now hand over to Arun to discuss the financials.
Thank you, Syed. A very good evening, and I thank everyone for taking out time and joining us on our quarterly earnings conference call. I would like to highlight the company's financial performance for the quarter and 6 months ended September 30th, 2021. For quarter financials, revenue from operations during the quarter was at 1657 crores as compared to 1591 crores in Q2 last year. Pharma revenue stood at 1543 crores versus 1516 crores in Q2 FY21. While contract research business reported revenue at rupees 108 crores as compared to 75 crores during Q2 FY21. Reported EBITDA during the quarter was at 344 crores as compared to 353 crores in Q2 FY21, with a margin of 20.8% versus 22.2% in Q2 FY21. Depreciation and amortization expenses during the quarter was at 100 crores versus 85 crores in Q2 FY21. Finance cost during the quarter was 35 crore versus 46 crore in Q2 FY21, a reduction of 25% year-on-year. Reported PAT during the quarter was at 143 crore as compared to 147 crore in Q2 last year. EPS for the quarter was at 8.97 per share versus 9.21 per share in Q2 FY21. Now moving on to H1 FY22 financials. For H1 22, revenue stood at 3,292 crores versus 2,747 crores in H1 FY21. Pharmaceutical revenue was at 3,085 crores versus 2,612 crores in H1 corresponding year. The contract research and development service revenue was recorded at 196 crores against 132 crores last year. The reported EBITDA for the period was at 723 crores versus 536 crores in H1 FY21. Depreciation and amortization expense was at 188 crore versus 167 crore in H1 last year. Finance cost stood at 69 crore versus 94 crore in H1 FY21. Average blended interest rate at H1 FY22 stood at 4.62% versus 5.17% in H1 FY22. PAT for the first half was at 303 crores versus 182 crore in H1 FY21. with EPS of 19.06 per share versus 11.44 per share in H1 FY21. Net debt on a constant currency basis on September 30, 2021 was at 1,823 crore versus 1,928 crore as on March 31, 2021. Net debt to EBITDA improved to 1.14 as on September 30, 2021 from 1.42 as on March 31, 2021. During the quarter, we saw our net debt increase by 173 crore, which was mainly attributable to temporary increase in working capital, which is expected to normalize during this financial year. On YTD basis, net debt on a constant currency basis was lower by 105 crores. Capital expenditure, excluding R&D capitalization, was at 131 crore for the quarter and 238 crore for H1 FY22. For full year, we maintain the same spend around 700 to 800 crores for this financial year. With this, I would like to conclude our opening remarks. We will now be happy to answer any question that you may have. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may please press star, then one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star, then two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. To ask a question, please press star, then one. Participants who would like to ask questions, please press star, then one. The first question is from the line of Rahul Veera from Abacus. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Congratulations on decent set of numbers. Sir, just a couple of questions from my end. Even though we executed a couple of CDMO contracts in this quarter, in terms of margins, sir, we are on the much lower side. Usually with CDMO contracts, we've seen the margins being on the upper end. I understand our radio pharma business is not yet fully back to the 2019 levels. But even after that, after considering that, the margin is still not 20%, is much lower. So can you throw some light here?
Thank you for your compliment. This is Pramod here. So the margins in CDMO are little lower because of two reasons. One is that the CDMO deal value in comparison to previous quarter, in this quarter was slightly lower. And in our CDMO business, we also include the API, where we mentioned that for some of the sartans, there was the product withdrawal. So that impacted the margin for the quarter.
Okay. So once our specialty pharma, that is radio pharma, comes back to normalization, do we see our margins moving close to 25% plus?
So the margins ultimately will move up to the very healthy levels, and that will be driven by our increasing installs of the Ruby fill, by our increasing launches of more of the generic products and our NDA I-131 MIB. And as the COVID continues to get normalized, overall those dispensing will increase because the elective diagnosis will come back to the normal level. So yes, the margins in the near term, like in the next 2 to 3 years, will bounce back to very healthy levels.
Thank you. We've lost the line for the current participant. We take the next question from the line of Vishal Manchanda from Nirmal Bang. Please go ahead. Excuse me, this is the operator. I'm sorry to interrupt. Sir, may we request you to use your handset, please? We can't hear you that well.
Am I audible now?
Yes, thank you.
Yeah. With respect to the radio pharma business, the radio pharmacy business, has that completely normalized or even that is yet to normalize?
this business in the month of April and May had almost normalized, because during that time the number of COVID cases in US had gone down substantially. However, from the June onwards, the COVID again started increasing, and June, July, August, September were the months where we were impacted by COVID. So the dose dispensing in that business had gone back to between 90% to 95%. But
okay,
from the last 1 week, we are again seeing the overall better trend in the US. So let's keep the fingers crossed.
And just want to understand the margin impact of the decline in radiopharmacy business. So at a gross margin level, it would be a healthy business. So all that you lose would kind of come out of the EBITDA. Is that right to assume?
Yeah, so we have been mentioning from the last two calls that we have put very robust strategic initiative in place in that business to grow the top line. You are right that if the top line grows, the cost at the pharmacy level is more or less remaining same, or it doesn't go up in the proportion of the top line. So you get a very healthy bottom line in the process. And along with that, we are also looking at improvement in operational efficiencies and the procurement efficiencies. And we mentioned that in 2 years' time frame, the business will be at the break-even. And we are tracking it, and we are on track as of now.
Okay. Any improvements that we can see this year in terms of 100 basis point margin improvement on account of the efficiency steps, the efficiency measures that you are taking?
So since we are already taking efficiency measures and we are already seeing the improvement, if the COVID situation doesn't deteriorate further, we expect this year our margins to be better than last year.
Okay. And where would be DTPA in terms of the normal volumes? Would it be down 50% or even lower?
Sorry, I couldn't get the question. If you can please repeat.
Where would be DTPA in terms of the volume, normal volume? So is it still 50% lower, or it has started to come back?
So it's extremely difficult to track the exact number on quarter, because this all will depend upon how many doses have been dispensed from the various pharmacies, from ours as well as from others. But we have seen a uptick in DTPA as well as MA in this quarter. However, this is not yet close to the normal level. It is still much lower.
It is not close to the normal level, you said?
Yes.
Got it.
So we have seen slight improvement, but we have yet a lot of paths to cover.
Okay. Thank you. That's all from me.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Tushar Manudhane from Motilal Oswal. Please go ahead.
So just would like to understand how much would have been the impact of these voluntary withdrawals, and that would have come under the raw material cost, right? So and affecting the overall gross margin.
It will be difficult to mention the exact amount that how much has been the impact. But if you can see our overall EBITDA margin in comparison to the previous quarter, gone down by about 2 to 2.5%, though the revenue is more or less same. So that much of the impact majorly has come due to these withdrawals, as well as the impact into the generic business and overall US pricing pressure into generic business.
So at least going forward, while this withdrawal will not have...
Excuse me, this is the operator. I'm sorry to interrupt. So your voice is not very clear. May I request you to use your handset?
Am I audible now?
Yes, it is. Thank
yeah.
You.
Okay. Okay. So, just for taking this further now, is this withdrawal exercise more or less done, and so we'll not have this impact in the coming quarters, or that will still continue?
So the withdrawal is done, but we will take about we will be back in the market in the next quarter.
So broadly, the basically trying to understand how the gross margin will, you know, have the trajectory going forward.
Yeah. So even in this quarter, though we will start putting the product back into the market, which will be free of the impurities, but it will get to the normal level in the last quarter of this financial year. So we will also see some impact of that in Q3.
Got it. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Tarang from Old Bridge Capital. Please go ahead.
Hello, team. Good evening. Thank you for your time. Two questions from my side. One, what is the gross block associated with the Roorkee facility, and how much of remediation cost do you anticipate over the next 12 to 15 months?
So your first part of question I missed. If you could please repeat again.
What is the gross block associated with the Roorkee capacity?
Okay. So when you are asking the gross block of the Roorkee capacity, means exactly what is that you are asking?
The value of the gross block associated with the Roorkee plant.
You know, I think, Pramod, it's about the fixed assets. So I think Chris will be able to answer. You can answer the second question.
Yes, Chris or Arun, would you like to answer?
Yeah, let me look at that and I'll have to get back to you.
Okay, so till he looks at, I can answer the second question, which you are asking about how much could be the remediation cost. We had already incurred quite a lot of remediation cost while we were taking actions on the warning letter observations. The observations which have come again in the last audit, because of which we have got the import alert, they require more of the some of the changes in our SOPs and the training to the operators and that kind of the remediation efforts, which really doesn't incur much cost. Much of the remediation cost. It's nowhere material.
Okay. So it's only a matter of time and getting those processes in place that this should help with the remediation, correct?
Yes, and that we indicated that we expect that we will be completing all that in early next calendar year.
Got it. My second question.
And then, yeah.
Yes, sorry, please go ahead.
No, I was saying that then we will let the FDA know, and then we will have to wait for the FDA to come and audit us.
Okay. My second question is relating to the CRDS business. I just read that you have recently just completed the expansion of the Noida Research Center, and correct me if I'm wrong, you suggested that maybe perhaps you're going in for a larger expansion given the demand environment, the burgeoning demand environment for this business. Would that be accurate?
So I request Giuliano to address this.
Yes, I'm here. So that's accurate. The capacity expansion I was referring to has been completed, and commercial operations commenced from September 2021. Then I mentioned further expansion we plan to do for the MPK and chemistry, and this will start generating additional revenue from first quarter 2023 on.
Sure. So Julian, just wanted to check, I mean, are these new campaigns that you're getting from your existing customers or new customers that are approaching you?
Yes, our current customer base is strong, and so we're leveraging existing customer as well, further developing the customer base.
I'm sorry, please come again. You're saying that you're getting new projects from your current customers, or is it really a mix of both?
We are leveraging our existing customer base, which is strong, and at the same time, we are continuing to further expand this customer base.
Okay. Thank you. That's it for me. I just wanted the gross block number. That'll be helpful. Thanks.
Thank you.
The assets at Rookie, the net assets at Rookie are $35 million net book value.
You are not audible, Chris.
The net book value of our assets at Rookie are $35
million. Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Rahul from Abacus. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Sir, a quick question from my end. Any other CDMO contracts from the COVID that we are forcing?
So we continue to explore the possibilities and the opportunities. And as and when we will be concluding any of the contracts, we will be informing about that.
Sure. So as of now, CDMO will largely be running on the previous old contracts, which are relatively low margin business. Is that correct to say?
No, it's let's not say low margin. Even our the normal business in the CMO also had a very healthy margin. They started looking with a little less in comparison to much better margin into COVID related deals. So yes, the COVID-related deals in Q3 and Q4 are not. So we had mentioned that the business will be coming back to the normal level.
Sure. Sir, quick question on the Jubilant Biosys side. Since we are entering in the clinical stage, are we looking to raise any funds, sir?
Sorry, could you kindly repeat, please?
Yeah, and the Jubilant Therapeutics and the Jubilant Biosciences, are you planning to raise any funds in either of them?
Let me answer this. This is Hari Bhartia.
Sure, sir.
As we have explained in the past, that in the therapeutics, we are looking to raise a crossover round for our projects which are going into clinic. In Biosys, we have no plans of raising funds right now.
Sure. Fair point, sir. Thank you so much. This is helpful.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Runjun Jain from Nirmal Bang. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity. Sir, just one clarification. So when this, sorry to ponder on this again and again, but when we got this import alert in the month of July, in the press release, we have mentioned that there is not much impact on non-exempted portfolio. So we have stated that it would be less than 3% of the revenue. So what has changed, and or if you can quantify the impact in this quarter, and it is likely to continue for next at least 2-3 quarters going forward also?
So for the non-exempted product, we had mentioned that there are the three conditions which FDA has put on us, which we have to comply with. Those three conditions included testing of the product at an independent laboratory and also taking the entire GMP verification by an independent consultant. You may appreciate in the GMP process to get the product tested at a different lab needs the method transfer, then analytical method validations, and then the product testing, etc. So it took some time. And same way for a GMP consultant also to virtually, remotely have access of all the production records and verify them and then give the GMP certificate also took some time. So that impacted the performance during the quarter. However, now we have geared up on both those things and the exempted product shipments have started going to the US now.
So you mean to say that during this quarter, Q2, there was kind of no sales from Roorkee, which would start of the exempted products from this Q3. Is that right to say?
Yeah. So after the import alert, the sales of exempted products from the Roorkee has started about 2 to 3 weeks ago, and it's ramping up.
Thank you. And sir, this last one, Nanjangud. So you said that we are doing, and the remediation is almost over from our side. So when we are expecting the next development on this, probably re-inspection or online re-inspection, so what is the next logical step there would be?
Yeah, FDA, to our best of understanding, FDA had not been doing online inspections for the normal GMP audit. They were doing online inspection for the selected, the product approval, etc. But now in the recent past, FDA has restarted doing the audits in India. We don't know that our Nanjangud plant comes where into their priority list, but we expect FDA to come and audit us soon.
Oh, thank you, sir.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Alankar Garude from Macquarie. Please go ahead.
Hi, good evening, everyone. So my first question is, amidst lower satin prices, what were the drivers for the strong sequential growth in the API business?
Could you please repeat that question?
So amidst lower satin prices, just wanted to understand what were the drivers for the strong sequential growth in the API business.
So other than sartans, we also have many other products, and even in the sartans also there was a demand. It's only the pricing pressure was mainly on the valsartan, where in the valsartan the prices during the nitrosamine impurity in the supply was very limited, had gone up substantially, which now have come back to the normal level. But other than the valsartan, we have a huge product range for the various therapeutic applications. And as you know, there is a higher demand from the APIs from China because there had been a lot of discussion about the reducing dependency from the Chinese supply chain. We saw the additional demand coming up because of that, and we had a the high volume sequentially. Though in comparison to a year ago, it still looked a bit lower because the last year was the exceptional quarter. In Q1, our plant was closed, so in Q2, the dispatches were very high.
Understood, sir. Is it also a factor of the debottlenecking exercise which is currently happening? So have we realized any benefit of that in this quarter?
That exercise is not like it's a one-time exercise. We have six plants and the various streams over there at that site. And plant by plant, stream by stream, we are doing the debottleneckings. And those action plans are on track. So depending upon the product, in some of the products where the debottlenecking has happened, we may have realized the benefit of that. But it has not been completed for all the products for all the streams.
Understood. So my second question is, you spoke about higher KSM and solvent prices and your ability to pass it on to consumers, the customers. Can there be some lag in passing on this higher input cost?
Yes, there could be some lag because one is that we do not know how much inventory our competitors are holding at the old price. So a customer may take time to negotiate and give us the revised price. So it could be lag. But in the API business, we have seen that whatever is the cost increase, generally it gets passed on into the finished good prices.
Understood, sir. And so just maybe a small follow-up there is, so these issues specifically pertaining to the China power outage problem, that could continue in this third quarter as well. So would it be fair to assume that the higher prices which we are seeing right now, those could continue in the third quarter as well?
We will start seeing the impact of higher prices. Some impact will start seeing in Q1, and we will see more impact in Q4 because we also are holding some inventory of the raw materials. But yes, in some part of Q3 and Q4, we will see impact of those prices, and we have to make the assessment how much we will be able to pass on. As of now, we expect we will be able to pass on complete increase with some lag.
Sure. That's it from my side. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Roshan Nair from Equintus Wealth. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity. My question pertains to more of generic business. So with that, the pricing pressure, lower volumes due to import alert and all these problems pertaining to generic business. So when can we see the revival in this segment of business?
Let me try and address that in a few parts. In terms of revival in the U.S. generic market, it's a cyclic pattern. Every 1 or 2 years, the price pressure comes. And when the price pressure comes, some of the weaker players who are not making margin, then they vacate the market. The market again becomes short, and then prices again start going up. So this cyclic pattern continues, and currently we are at the bottom of the cycle. The other impact on us is because of the import alert. So the products which currently are restricted for import into US, we are making arrangements to get them contract manufactured at third party, and then from those locations start bringing them into the US. But this process takes time. Generally, the process takes about 8 months to 12 months. For the products which are exempted, that, as I mentioned earlier, that we are streamlining the issues, and we have started supplying the products to the U.S. market. And the fourth and last is that we don't expect that import alert should last long. We are hopeful that in the next audit, we will be able to get this import alert lifted. Once that happens, then anyway, the situation becomes normal. Till then, whatever capacity we are having, we are also trying to maximize that capacity for the non-US markets. So we are taking the various initiatives to minimize the impact to minimize the impact of this import alert.
Okay, and my other question is relating to the capacity expansion at Robiful manufacturing capacity. So when can we expect the ramp up, or in the first year, what could be the percentage in terms of a ramp up of the facility?
You are asking for Roorkee or for US?
The one which saw the doubling of manufacturing capacity.
So we had almost doubled the capacity in the Cadista in our US dosage form facility. And in my speech, I mentioned doubling capacity of the Ruby fill in at our Montreal facility. Your question is for which business?
The US one.
US one.
Yeah.
So the capacity, whatever the investments we had made in that, is now available. And as I mentioned, that we expect to put the Sartans back in the market towards the later part of this quarter and ramp up into the next quarter. This increased capacity will help us quite a lot to get much better market share in FY23 in the US market.
Okay, all my other questions are answered. Thanks a lot for the question.
Thank you.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants to ask a question, please press star and then one. The next question is from the line of Vivek Gupta, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Hi, thanks for the opportunity. So probably some of the questions are answered earlier, but a couple of questions still are left in my queue to ask. So first one is, I see that the trade receivables are towards the higher end during this quarter, along with the inventory. So what would be the reasons for it?
The inventory is higher because of these few of the disturbances we talked about the market withdrawal or the import alert, where we had continued the production of the exempted products, but we were in the process of fulfilling the conditions of the FDA. And so that as soon as those conditions are fulfilled, supplies can go. So that was the reason on the inventory side. On the trade receivable side, I'll say that it may be only the timing and the product mix impact.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So one more request I would like is, like, I find there are no exchange filings coming from Jubilant Pharmova side about the updates. And it is only at the time of results that you mention all the details in your presentation. So it would be great if we have some intermediate press releases to better understand what is going on from the company's business perspective.
So
the other question is, go ahead, please, sir.
Yeah, I say whenever there is any material event, which as per the requirement we have to inform, we ensure that that information goes to stock exchange.
Just to quote with an example is, like, recently you were mentioned in the presentation citing that you have submitted to NCLT about the reorganization scheme for this Jubilant generics with the Jubilant Pharmova. There was no exchange filing corresponding to the same. It was done in September, I suppose, correct?
I think there was an exchange filing. We have Arvind on the call.
Yes, that's right.
We have Arun on the call. Can you?
Yeah, we did the filing on the relevant date also.
It was done, Vivek, at the time of the last quarter results announcement. And it was very well covered with the proper exchange filing, Vivek. You might have a look at that.
No, that is fine. About the, I'm talking more from the NCLT submission perspective. In the last con call,
these are the intermediate steps. There are so these are intermediate steps. There are 5 or 6 steps in the path, as you know, Vivek. So when we informed in the last first quarter results, along with the exchange filing, and we announced public announcement, and that it was clearly mentioned, and we can share that with you, that announcement, and you can get that from the stock exchange website. It details all the steps and procedures. This is just an intermediate update we are giving the journey, and it said that it will be effective on 1st April next year, and there'll be all kind of processes that will run in the meantime. Yeah.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Jay, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir. Congratulations for decent set of number. And I believe with the kind of product and management bandwidth we have got, we would be able to pull up. So a couple of questions, sir. One is on Europe foray for Rubifil. And second one is on, if you can show some lights on SOFIE Biotech partnership? How is it going, and do we look at increasing stake in SOFIE Biotech? And third one, and probably, there are many management interviews being done by the various business channels. So I could hardly see our management coming on the business channels and, discussing the business updates. So if you could do it more frequently, would be helpful for individual investors. Thank you, sir.
Sujit, thank you for the compliments. And your third point, which you made, is duly noted. And we will take the necessary action on that. On the two of the questions on the RUBY-FILL Europe, so we got the approval in the RUBY-FILL Europe, in the Europe, and we have started doing the installations in the Europe as well, other than the US and Canada, where we have been doing earlier. So that's an additional geography which we have started developing, and we are getting a good traction on that. And your the second question was, if you can just make me recall again.
It's on SOFIE Biotech partnership, and we have what plans we have got for that partnership.
Yeah, it's SOFIE Biosciences. They have three business verticals. They have the network of PET radiopharmacies, where we have many of the complementing things with them in terms of overall distribution and acquisition of the customers. So there, the cooperation is continuing. The other piece is they had these very the novel assets called FAPI for the diagnostic and the therapeutic applications. For the therapeutic, they have out-licensed this to Novartis, and for the diagnostic, they have kept it themselves. They are, as of now, in the process of taking the approvals of that from the US FDA, so they are making the filings. And their third business vertical is doing contract manufacturing for these radioactive isotopes along with the ligand, and then helping the other the biotech companies, pharma companies, and universities to develop the product. We see a lot of synergies into our business with their business. About the pharmacy, I have already talked about. They have good products for them to for the distribution, and I can speak about them because that's in the public knowledge. You know that Biogen product is approved for the Alzheimer's. They also have agreements with the company called LMI, who has a Neuraceq, the product which is required for the diagnosis for the Alzheimer's. Earlier, the Neuraceq was not getting too much of the traction because therapeutic application was not available. Now, with therapeutic application being available, they will have a substantial the business for the dispensing of the Neuraceq. And same way, they also have the other contracts for the PSMA product on the PSMA side, which is also expected to bring healthy revenue and the margins for them. So we are very happy and satisfied with our investment, and we are very confident that this investment will give healthy returns.
Thank you, sir, and all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the last question. I now hand the conference over to the management for closing comments.
Thank you so much for the conference call, and wishing all of you a very happy Diwali in advance. Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Jubilant Pharmova Limited, that concludes this conference. We thank you all for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.